Let us first understand what text summarization is before we look at how it works. Here is a definition to get us let us started. See, automatic text summarization is the task of producing a concise and fluent summary while preserving key information content and overall meaning. There are broadly two different approaches that are used for text summarization. One is extractive summarization, second one is abstractive summarization. Let's look at these two types in a bit more detail. Extractive summarization, as the name gives away that this approach does, we identify the important sentences or phrases from the original text and extract only those from the text. Those extracted sentences would be our summary. The below diagram illustrates extractive summarization. Abstractive summarization is a very interesting approach. Here we generate new sentences from the original text. This is in contrast to the extractive approach we saw earlier, where we used only the sentences that were present. The sentences generated through abstractive summarization might not be present in the original text. Let's discuss on sequence-to-sequence modeling. We can build a sequence-to-sequence model on any problem which involves sequential information. This includes sentiment classification, neural machine translation, and named entity recognition, and some very common applications of sequential information. In the case of neural machine translation, the input is a text in one language and the output is also a text in another language. In the named entity recognition, the input is a sequence of words and the output is a sequence of tags for every word in the input sequence. Our objective is to build a text summarizer where the input is a long sequence of words and the output is a short summary. So we can model this as a many-to-many sequence-to-sequence problem. There are two major components of a sequence-to-sequence model: encoder and decoder. Let us understand these two in detail. These are essential to understand how text summarization works underneath the code. You can also check out the encoder-decoder architecture is mainly used to solve the sequence-to-sequence problems where the input and output sequence are of different lengths. Let us understand this from the perspective of text summarization. The input is a long sequence of words and the output is a short version of the input sequence. Generally, variants of recurrent neural networks, that is gated recurrent neural networks or GRUs, long short-term memory LSTM, are preferred as the encoder and decoder components. This is because they are capable of capturing long-term dependencies by overcoming the problem of vanishing gradient. We can set up the encoder-decoder in two phases. One is the training phase and the inference phase. This is the data set I am using. Here you can see the test data and the training data. If you open the training data, there are huge number of files here. And if you open one file from this, you can see the content here and the highlight of this
the entire content is given here, and the highlight of this is only this much. This is the summary of this text. So all the files are like this only. You can see it here. So this is the text, and the highlight is given here. By using these files, we are training the model. After that, if you see the text data set, this is the test data set. There in this, there is no highlight. We will use these files to test the model. Let me show you the code I have developed. See here, I am iterating through the folder, and iterating through all the files in the directory. After that, I am reading the files, and the content is appended in a data frame. So I am showing the data frame here. This is the data frame. Here you have file name, text, and the summary. Summary we are extracting after the highlight. I am using the search word highlight, and if the search word is there in the file, we will reading and it is adding to the data frame as summary. After that, I am using the GenSim library. You may be familiar with the GenSim to create the feature vectors, and I have used the NLTK, Natural Language Toolkit, also both NSIM and NLTK I have used. There is one method that is the simple underscore pre-process method in the GenSim library. I have used that method to clean the data in the data frame. So I have used that method and it is cleaned. And one more, I have added one more column in the data frame, that is file name, text, summary, clean text, and clean summary. So this is text and this is the cleaned text, this is the summary and this is the clean summary. After that, I am using the sklearn library to split the data into training and testing data. You can see it here, and I have taken the length, max length as the 80 and the max length summary as 10. Then I am downloading the NLTK, from NLTK I am downloading this puncti. That is done. After that, I am using the LSTMs to create the model. We are finally at the model building part, but before we do that, we need to familiarize ourselves with a few terms which are required prior to building the model. Return sequences is equal to true. When the return sequence parameter is set to true, LSTM produces the hidden state and cell state for every time step. Return state equal to true. When return state is equal to true, LSTM produces the hidden state and cell state of the last timestamp only. Initial state. This is used to initialize the internal states of the LSTM for the first timestamp. Stacked LSTM. Stacked LSTM has multiple layers of LSTM stacked on top of each other. This leads to a better representation of the sequence. I encourage you to experiment with the multiple layers of the LSTM stacked on top of each other. Here we are building a three stacked LSTM for the encoder.
You can see the code here. Sorry, just one second. This is the code I have written from Keras. We are importing the backend. And this is the output we are getting. Here I am training the model. I am using the sparse categorical, cross entropy as the loss function since it converts the integer sequence to a one-hot vector on the fly. This overcomes any memory issues. Here the concept of early stopping. It is used to stop training the neural network at the right time by monitoring a user-specified metrics. So that's also we are doing it here during training. You can see the code here. We will plot a diagnostic plot to understand the behavior of the model over time. You can see it here. This is the plot. We can infer that there is a slight increase in the variation of loss after each epoch 10. So we will stop training the model after this epoch.